is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. We have a cool episode for you this week, Building a Successful DSO. Lots of useful information here that I think all of you will find information that you can use in your own practice. Before we get to that, though, a couple of announcements. First announcement that I have for you is that we're doing our first ever masterclass. This is a 3-hour workshop, and it's on the 6 steps to successfully resign from PPO plans. That class will be on Wednesday, February 17th, 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern. Go ahead and convert that to whatever time zone you happen to be in. It's 3 hours. As I mentioned, it's done as a workshop format. It's all about the 6 steps to successfully resign from PPO plans. We made that very attractive. You get 3 hours of CE credits. It's an $89 tuition. We will limit attendance to 20 doctors. We will strictly limit attendance because we'll run it more like a workshop than a lecture. If you go to lessinsurancedependence.com/masterclass, you'll find all the information about that masterclass. There'll be a counter on that page that tells you whether there's seats available in the workshop. We do anticipate selling out. Go to that page. lessinsurancedependence.com/masterclass. It's in the show notes, which are on thrivingdentist.com. Come join us. We'd love to have you in that masterclass. Now, I've got another top clinical tip. If you're a regular listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you know we've added a new feature called Top Clinical Tips. Today, we're very privileged to have Dr. Marcus Blatz as a contributor to our top clinical tips. He is world-renowned for his expertise, and he's going to talk about how to successfully bond to zirconia using the APC technique. So he'll dispel a myth. Some of you may think, wait a minute, you can't bond to zirconia. Well, he's going to successfully dispel that myth for you. Dr. Blatz has much experience in this area, and I think you'll enjoy his top clinical tip. Without further ado, here's that top clinical tip from Dr. Marcus Blatz.
Hi there. This is Marcus Blatz from the University of Pennsylvania School of Dental Medicine. And my clinical tip is about bonding to zirconia. You may know this has been a topic I've researched for almost 20 years. Yet, so many times I hear my colleagues saying, well, you cannot bond zirconia. It's not possible. There's no chemical bond. Well, let me tell you something. It is quite possible if you know how to do it. First of all, clarify that a conventional zirconia crown that has good retention does not necessarily require resin bonding. You can use conventional cementation. But there may be clinical instances, for example, lack of retention or a non-retentive restoration, such as a resin bonded bridge, where you want to bond to zirconia. And the way to do it, based on the years of research we have done and confirmed by many other groups, is what I call the APC technique. APC stands for, a first step is air particle abrasion with aluminum oxide particles, typically, you know, 30 to 60 micron particle size at about 2 bars for about 10 seconds is totally sufficient to pre-treat the zirconia surface, a air particle abrasion, or some people say sandblasting. The next step is P, the primer. You need a special primer that can chemically bond to zirconia. There are several primers available now, and they typically contain a certain phosphate monomer that can bond to metal oxide, MDP, is one example. So P as a primer. And C is the composite. You need a composite resin eluting agent, of course, in between the tooth and your zirconia. So here you go. APC, air abrasion, primer, and composite. On the tooth side, of course, you need to use the recommended dentin bonding agent that comes with the adhesive system of your choice. But again, the goal was to tell you, how do you bond to zirconia? And the best way to do it, where the literature stands right now, is the APC technique, air abrasion, primer, composite. Thanks so much, guys. Happy bonding.
Hello, everyone. This is Naren, the co-host of the Thriving Dentist Show. In today's Thriving Dentist Coaching and Action segment, we are going to be talking about building a successful DSO. As many of you have heard probably from Gary before, Gary talks about creating a life where you have personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. And many of the people that Gary works with in his coaching work are very ambitious. And of course, one of the things they pay attention to is their financial success and satisfaction. And one of the ways you can achieve that is by creating a successful DSO, or at least thinking about it, and at least thinking as if you are running one. So you can do the things that successful DSOs do. So today's episode is an awesome episode. We're going to have some fun. Gary, let's jump in.
You know, Naren, let's start. There may be some of our listeners that aren't familiar with the acronym DSO. DSO stands for Dental Service Organization. It's another way to say group or another way to say corporate. Now, Naren, I want to myth bust to begin with. I want to bust a myth. And if this was a live audience, obviously it's not because it's a podcast audience, but if it was a live audience, I'd ask this question. How many of you have heard something negative about corporate dentistry? And every hand would go up. Every hand would go up, in dentistry. And then I would say, just stick with me for a minute. I'm going to ask you a question. Among private, so Naren, you and I have never done this. True disclosure, you didn't know I was going to do this now, correct?
Correct.
I'm going to put you on the spot, just like I would if you're in the audience. Naren, I'm going to ask you a question, and you tell me if what I'm about to say is true. Among private practice dentists, there's some really good ones. There's some okay ones, and there's some schmucks. Would that be true, Naren?
Absolutely. Like in any group, like even an ethnic group, right? There's going to be good people and there's going to be some schmucks.
Well, let's just go stay in business. Among restaurants, are there some really good ones?
Yeah.
Are there some okay ones?
Yeah.
And are there some that you should run as fast as you can the other way?
Exactly. Absolutely.
So now we said that about private practice. I'm going to extend this. Naren, among corporate dentistry, is it possible that there's some really good ones, there's some okay ones, and then there's some schmucks? Is that possible?
100% correct.
Exactly. So I love starting this episode that way because, in fact, there are some very good DSOs, and they take all kinds of different formats and different flavors. Oftentimes, a small DSO, by the way, is defined as 3 to 20 locations. 3 to 20. So if you're a dentist that maybe has created a successful first office and you're really enjoying it and you're ambitious and you decide that, you know, what we've done here is pretty cool, I think I'd like to scale and do more. We're helping patients. I'd like to help more patients. And let's say you acquire another practice and then another one, and then another one. You get to 4. Well, then technically you have a small DSO. 3 to 20 is considered a small DSO. I'm not sure what we call 2 locations. Maybe growing to become a small DSO. Maybe that's what we call 2. Yes. But then the next would be mid-sized DSO. A mid-sized DSO would be 21 to 50 locations, 21 to 50. Large DSO would be considered anything more, 51 or more locations. And by the way, the largest DSOs in the United States, the largest have hundreds of locations. The largest one is close to 1,000 locations. But, you know, obviously that's, I just wanted to provide some definitions. And Naren, you know, that in my work as a coach, most of my clients over the years, have been, you know, owners of their practice. They might be a partnership. You know, they might be an owner, an associate. It might be a small group. But I have had the experience and privilege with working with a number of ambitious dentists that are building DSOs. And I've had a bit of experience with that. And frankly, it's been a very enjoyable project. One of them, I'll leave names out of it because I didn't ask their permission, but they had a really cool mission. And their mission was to build a DSO by dentists for dentists. And what that meant, they said, you know, hey, Gary, we realize that that in our area, young dentists don't have a great place to go career-wise. So we want to build the DSO by dentists for dentists. So dentist-owned, and we want to attract and keep the best possible associate dentists inside this DSO. And frankly, this group has done very well at doing that, to the point of now having 14 locations. And they are absolutely following up on their promise to build a DSO by dentists for dentists that really serves their patients extremely well. So I have considerable experience in this, and I thought it might be a fun episode to kind of bounce around some ideas with our audience. It's not for everybody. I remember talking to a client of mine years ago. He's since retired. But when he was 5 or 6 years away from retirement, I said, how would you feel? You know, you're doing a great job with your practice. How would you feel about a second location and maybe even a third or fourth? And he looked at me with wide eyes and he said, Gary, he said, I struggle enough with managing one location. That sounds like Chinese water torture to me. And so clearly this is not something for everybody. But it is something that you may want to consider, especially in the context of, you know, creating a career that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. So let's talk about how to consider this. The first thing that you need to do is you need to develop a stellar flagship office, a flagship practice. And that needs to be your proof of concept. So you really need to have your first practice fine-tuned, performing, you know, on all cylinders and really ideal before expanding. Because if the first one's still a work in progress and you expand, where do you think that's going to lead, Naren?
It's going to lead to repeating the mistakes and the problems of the first practice into 10 others. And now you're fixing 10 practices versus just...
You'll need an asbestos suit with a high pressure hose, and you'll constantly be putting out fires. So that's just that's not a way to practice and not a way to create an enjoyable career. So your first practice really needs to be fine-tuned, really needs to be buffed out, and really needs to be performing extremely well. So let me talk about what that looks like. You're achieving the 6 goals of a thriving practice. Let's walk through those 6 goals real quick. Overhead no higher than 60%. Number one, overhead no higher than 60%, ideally 50. Number two, enough income from your practice to create financial independence for yourself over time. Number three, all the technology that makes dentistry fun for you and more effective for your patients and still controlling overhead 60% or less. Number four, a high-performance team you truly love and enjoy working with. Number five, patients that give you satisfaction. And number six, treatment mix that allows you to kind of do the dentistry that you love to do. When you have all 6 of those checked off the list, I would say it's time to consider expanding, because you've created a flagship that has a foundation that you can then build on. Does that make sense, Naren?
Absolutely, Gary. So what you're saying is, don't, you know, duplicate what you're doing till you have that one practice that have achieved these 6 goals.
Till you have something worth duplicating.
Exactly.
And part of that, I already said the 6 goals, but I would also say that you have a rock solid suite of systems in your practice. And in our case, you know, Naren, that in my coaching work, we have 24 business systems, 24.
Right.
And those systems help the practice run like a finely tuned Swiss watch. And then we train great people to run those systems, and we really have something magical there. So it's not only, it's a bit of a chicken and egg discussion. Which comes first, the systems or the achievement of the goals? I would argue the systems are what allow you to achieve the goals. So you need to also have a systems-based practice, because there's no way you can scale, and that's what we're talking about doing, is scaling. There's no way you can scale unless you have rock-solid systems that you can hand off, you know, in the next location.
We're going to add a link to this particular, Gary did an episode about the six goals. Is it okay, Gary, if you add a link to that episode?
You bet. And Naren, we also did the, we've done two separate episodes on the 24 systems, and we had to divide it in two for time. And we did part one, which was the first 12 systems, and then part two were 13 through 24. Let's put those in the show notes as well. Fair enough?
Absolutely, Gary. Yes.
Now, let me tell you about a development that maybe some of our listeners are aware of and maybe some are not. Let's talk about the investment community. Businesses that are all about in the business of investing and making money. Most of us think, when we think investments, we think in terms of private equity. Private equity is a type of investment firm that is interested in. They're not interested in sexy businesses that would, like venture capital is the other firm. So let's compare venture capital and private equity. Venture capital is who we often think of when we think of investment firms. Venture capital firms are all about finding the next Google, finding the next Facebook, finding the next Microsoft. They're really professional gamblers. Venture capital firms know that if they make 20 investments in a startup company, emerging company, 19 of them are going to fail, are going to flat out fail and be bankrupt. But the one out of the 20 is going to provide a massive rate of return. And that'll more than counteract the 19 that failed. That's, in a nutshell, venture capital. Private equity, on the other hand, is the complete opposite. Safe, conservative, they invest in cash flow, not in, you know, betting on some big development happening. They invest in conservative cash flow, and private equity loves dentistry, because dentistry done right is largely recession proof. People need it in good times or bad. It provides a very attractive rate of return, and private equity has become smitten with dentistry as an industry, as a profession. And many of the large DSOs are owned by private equity. But private equity really loves dentistry. So I wanted to introduce that concept to our listeners, because they may not be familiar with private. And, you know, hey, I encourage you, go Google private equity and learn as much as you can about that. But they are interested as, and typically what private equity is, there could be many different types of private equity firms. It could be a family fund that's all owned by one family that makes investments. It could be a pool of funds where investors invest in private equity, and they provide the funding for this private equity firm to go out and buy businesses. But private equity is in love, absolutely in love with dentistry. And now let's add another layer to this complex conversation, Naren, and let's talk about valuation. Valuation. What's a practice worth? So doctors, you know, in a typical environment, you'll work in your practice, you'll develop it over time, and there'll become a time when it's time for you to retire and you sell it. And typically, in a typical model, you sell it to another dentist who then becomes your successor, hopefully comes in on your shoulders and continues to take wonderful care of your patients and maybe build it in his or her image, you know, as they continue to grow. Let's talk about valuation. What is it? What is a practice worth? Naren, you're fairly familiar with that, correct?
Yeah, I am.
What historically, what is a practice worth when a doctor goes to sell that practice? Now, lots of variables involved. It depends on the quality of the equipment. It depends on how much insurance is involved. It depends on the profit of the practice, location, all kinds of other things. And when we talk about the value of the practice, Naren, I'm talking about the value of the practice asset independent from the real estate. I'm not talking about buying the building. I'm talking about buying the practice, which is all of the asset independent from the real estate. What's a typical valuation, or what's your understanding of a typical valuation scenario historically in dentistry?
Yeah. So valuation, you know, why does someone buy a business, right? They buy a business because it's going to give cash flow. For example, you open the practice after you bought it. First month, you're going to make X amount of profits. That's why somebody who's buying that practice is paying you $600,000, $1 million, $5 million, whatever the number is. So how do they arrive at that number? So typically, especially when it comes to DSOs or larger businesses.
Well, let's talk about one practice selling to another dentist.
Okay, so one practice selling to another dentist. I think in the US, it depends on the state or province, because some places there's more competition for practice ownership and there's fewer practices. So this might change a little bit. But in typically, I've heard 80% of gross as the number that they use to value a practice. So for example, if the practice is making $1 million, maybe it's 800,000.
So typically, you're close. Okay. Typically, and of course you're in Canada, where valuations are a little bit stronger.
Yeah.
Here in the US, historically, practices have been worth 60 to 80% of the average annual collections averaged over the last 3 years.
Okay, 60 to 80%.
So that 800,000, that $1 million practice,
yeah,
is worth between 600 and 800. That's the historic, if we look at it over the last 30 years, 40 years.
Right. In some states, it might be different, right? California, I understand it's a little bit more
expensive. Could be higher. And what we're seeing now is we're seeing the percentages nudge up a little bit. And it might be safe to say that what we're seeing today looks maybe more like 70 to 80%.
Okay.
And it could even be 70 to 82%.
Right.
You know, at least here in the US.
Right.
So typically that's where valuation has been. And so, you know, if the dentist had $1 million practice, and let's say it's, you know, has equipment that is modern and up to date, has beautiful leasehold improvements, is relatively profitable, and doing well, you know, it might be worth 80%. It might be worth $800,000. And that becomes a nice, you know, contribution to their net worth when it's time to sell. Right. However, the valuation model is very different when you sell to a DSO. It can be worth 2 to 3 to 4 times that when you sell to a DSO. And today, the fact that if your practice is above a certain size, and usually that size is roughly $1 million, the DSOs are very interested in looking at your practice to acquire. And they will typically give you a premium for it, a little bit more, often a 10% premium. You know, so if your practice is worth 800 selling to another dentist, it might be worth 850 to 900 selling it to a DSO. And frankly, that's been a good development for senior doctors that are interested in selling, because we have another buyer now, you know, in addition to the normal brokers and finding other dentists to buy the practice. But the valuation model is different when you're selling to a DSO. Now, if you own a DSO, the valuation model becomes very, very, very attractive. So if you own a DSO that has a certain size and then you sell to a private equity, it can be worth a multiple again of the kind of numbers that we're seeing if you sell to a DSO. So I don't want to plug in numbers to give false expectations, because it is a moving target.
Yeah.
But suffice to say that if you developed a DSO that was above a certain size, and the size isn't so much the number of locations, but I'm going to introduce a new acronym that all of our listeners need to know, EBITDA, EBITDA is a financial term. It's an acronym that stands for EBITDA. That is the acronym. Earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, amortization. EBITDA. EBITDA is how they just kind of run it on and pronounce it as if it was an actual word, you know, EBITDA. And what they're looking for, they want an EBITDA event. You know, we've typically talked about profitability. I want overhead no higher than 60%. That's the a dentist model. But if you have a DSO, we want earnings of at least 20% after paying all expenses. You want an EBITDA of at least 20% after paying yourself as a dentist, after paying your associate, your partners, other dentists, all your expenses. You want earnings of at least 20%. And, you know, in the DSOs that I've worked with, that I've helped develop, we often see earnings closer to 25%. And when we see those kind of earnings, it becomes very attractive to private equity, because obviously, you know, a 20% earnings is attractive to them. They love 20%. But if they love 20%, how do they feel about 25%, Naren?
They love it even more.
They love it even more. It becomes even more valuable. But there have been a number of cases, a number of examples of, here's the typical model, Naren. A dentist absolutely loves dentistry, loves his or her practice, develops it to full potential, puts a team around him that is as passionate about dentistry as they are. And then he says, you know, he or she says, hey, I've done this once. I wonder if I could do it again. Right. And he or she will buy another practice far enough away so it's not competitive, maybe a fixer-upper where he or she could develop it. And then that one becomes kind of a stepping stone to do a third and a fourth and a fifth, you know, and so on. And all the while creating a very, very interesting financial value in doing so. And that's really what we're talking about in developing a small DSO. And again, it could be anywhere from 3 locations to 20 to be a small DSO. I worked, have a client that within, let's see, 5 years of graduating from dental school, he owns 10 practices. Hmm. 10 within 5 years. Now, he's very business minded. Business, he's as interested in business as he is in dentistry. But he went from no practices to 10 in less than 5 years, you know, coming out of dental school. Very successful locations. And he's not interested in selling. You know, that's the other thing is, you know, you can work towards an exit where I'm going to build this to get to a certain point and then sell to private equity. Or you might look at it and say, why in the world? Now, I won't use this doctor's name, so I can actually use the numbers, Naren. I'll ask you to do math. You do math on air pretty well. So I'm going to ask you to do the math. Is that okay?
Yes, please.
10 practices that are collectively, all 10 of them, doing about $22 million in revenue. $22
million. Okay.
With 20% earnings.
Okay.
20% earnings. What is he earning a year in the profit from those 10 practices?
$4.4 million.
So, and by the way, if he was to sell to private equity, it would be worth a very attractive multiple of that 4.4. But he's saying, he's young, he's saying, why should I strangle the goose that lays the golden egg?
Right.
Now, this dentist actually still does dentistry by choice. He does dentistry about 2.5 days a week. He spends the other time actually running this DSO, but he actually still does dentistry. He gets paid as a dentist. So he gets paid as a dentist for his production, his collections, but then he also gets paid, you know, as the owner of this DSO. And I've asked him, you know, we're kind of in the middle of figuring this out. I've said, how many locations do you think you'd like to have? And he said, you know, I'm pretty happy now. At where I am, but I'm thinking if I can do 10, I could probably double it. I could probably get to 20. And then it'll be a matter of lifestyle. You know, do I want to work that hard to do 20? It's not easy. I don't want to sugarcoat it and pretend this is easy. But he's kind of thinking down the road that, you know, he could have somewhere down the road, he could have, you know, 20 practices. But right now he's not thinking about exit because he's looking at the earning. Why should I strangle the goose that lays a golden egg? And it, you know, we've got systems. It's being run very, very well.
I just wanted to take a moment, Gary, to ask you a question. And I know you've helped a lot of practices with, you know, to kind of a single owner who builds that perfect practice that can be duplicated. And then, of course, once you have that duplicated, you know, duplicatable practice, how do I do the second and the third and the fourth and the fifth? Would you mind if, for our listeners only, we put a link in the show notes to a coaching strategy meeting? The way the doctors can get to this is by going to thrivingdentist.com/coaching, or we will put a link directly to the coaching strategy meeting. And the reason I am suggesting this, Gary, is because even in your current client base, there are people who are very ambitious. And yes, many of them have one or two locations, but who knows, one day they may want to expand and grow or be part of something that's bigger. So yeah. Maybe 1 hour with you where somebody can talk about this might be beneficial.
Hey, I would love to do that, Naren. I would be thrilled to do that. If you're interested, and you know, if you have that ambition, it's music to my ears, and I'd love to talk to you. And I could share a lot more information that we simply don't have time to get into in a podcast episode. But I could share a lot more information about multiples, about private equity, you know, valuations, what it's worth, what it could be worth, and perhaps in a positive way, feed your ambition. I'd love to do that. So again, thrivingdentist.com /coaching. Click that and you'll see a tab. It's called a coaching strategy meeting. It'll be with me. And we'll talk confidentially about this and about your ambition, about whether, you know, this is something that might be worthwhile. It's not for everybody. And I'm not suggesting that it could be for everyone, but for the right individual with the right reasons and the right skill set and the right mothership, you know, where you develop that first, could be very, very, very attractive. And I would love to open that up to our listeners. Be happy to do that, Naren. Well, hey, we've got some great questions. Why don't we hit pause here on this coaching in action section and get to these questions that should add more texture to this conversation for sure.
In today's Thriving Dentist Q&A segment, we are going to be asking Gary a few questions from our audience about DSOs. Gary, let me jump into the very first question. I know in the last few years, private equity has been very interested in dentistry. Do you see that changing post-COVID or anytime in the future?
You know, Naren, I'm in contact with principals in private equity, and I've asked that question to many of them. And obviously, it's a moving target. At the time of recording this episode, we're still dealing with COVID-19. It's an unfolding challenge. So it's still happening. But here's what I hear from principals in private equity. Here's what they're telling me. They say, you know what, Gary, the fundamentals are so solid in dentistry. Look at your profession. They said, while we do not mean to make light of any dentists that have been very adversely affected financially by COVID-19. The truth is, your profession has done far better than most businesses.
Yes.
You know, think about restaurant owners. How have restaurant owners done in, you know, the COVID-19 world?
The reason is, Gary, because they have low margins. I mean, the private equities after practices that are well-run, that have, like you said, 20% or more in EBITDA. So those practices actually are growing. I mean, we see that, you know, in the work you're doing with clients, you know, those practices are now doing even better, you know, after COVID or during COVID than they did before even.
Most practices in terms of the immediate period post-shutdown, you know, when we were shut down last spring, in March and in April and early May, when most practices came back, most of them did very well in coming back. No one knew what to expect, but most did fairly well. That wasn't missed by private equity. And frankly, if they're already invested in DSOs, they have their own data to look at, and they realize that, wait a minute, this is a business that is not only recession-proof, it's maybe pandemic-proof. And that's what I'm hearing from them. What I'm hearing from them is, if anything, Gary, we're more interested in dentistry as a investment category than we were pre-COVID, because performance after the shutdown has been even better than we've seen in other segments.
I mean, even if you look at the current stock market, right? A lot of the tech companies have doubled in valuation. And that's because of the cash flow. Like, many tech companies have a large cash flow.
Well, it's also situational.
DSO is the same thing.
How do you think Zoom did?
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, so a lot of it has to do with, do you have a product or service that, is pandemic proof? And while there's, I don't know, there's any such thing as pandemic proof, truly.
Yeah.
But you can have businesses that are better off. Veterinarians have done very well post pandemic, because in with people spending more time at home, and their four-legged family members are even more important to them. Emotionally, they're taking better care of them. Another industry which private equity invests in, veterinary medicine, has done very well. But dentistry is another one of those on their radar that says it's done very well. So my quick answer to that is, if anything, dentistry is more attractive to private equity than it was pre-COVID-19.
Right. Let me ask the next question. How many locations do I need to qualify for a higher valuation when I go to sell my DSO or my practice with a bunch of locations to a private equity firm?
Okay. I want to immediately change your perspective, doctor. Great question, by the way. Brilliant. Clearly, this is a dentist that understands a little bit about all this stuff. And I'm going to ask you to change your perspective. Number of locations is not the key. EBITDA is the key, your earnings. Think about it for a minute, Naren. What if you had 10 locations that were each doing $1 million a year, and you had 20% EBITDA? So you've got
$2
million a year in revenue, $2 million a year in EBITDA.
Yeah.
That's one possibility. Compared to another DSO that had 4 locations, each doing 2.5, with a 20% EBITDA. It's the same $10 million.
Yeah.
The private equity would be more interested in the second location. And let's say, because it's more profitable, what if their EBITDA was 25% instead of 20, because they're not carrying overhead in 10 locations, they're carrying overhead in only 4. Then, and do the math on that, Naren.
$2.5 million
in 4 locations earnings instead of $2 million in 10 locations. So it's not about the number of locations. It's about your earnings. And
so
I will
tell you, the bigger the EBITDA, the higher the multiple. That's what you're saying.
Correct. So to start getting really attractive earnings, this is very ballpark. The private equity is going to like to see somewhere between $5 and $10 million a year.
In EBITDA. Okay.
5 to 10. Now, as it gets north of that, it becomes even more attractive with more attractive multiples. Now, if you had $4 million in earnings, could it attract a suitor from private equity? You bet. But you might not get the premium multiples at that, because at some level they look at the dollar amounts, and more is better for them, for sure.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the next question. When would it make sense to create an administrative support team to provide business and admin support for my locations?
This is where DSOs get really exciting, because when you think about it, Naren, you think about a solo facility location. Everything has to be done right there. And the team members are somewhat generalists, because they have to do a number of different things. I helped a client go from 2 locations to 14, 2 to 14. And we discovered that once we hit 4 locations, we could build an admin center, a small administrative center to support their offices. And they could do things where we could have super qualified team members to do things like call center to field the phone calls coming in. They could make all the outbound reactivation contact. They could handle accounts payable, accounts receivable, insurance follow-up, even supply ordering. And that way, the team in the location only had to take care of their patients. And think what happens to customer service when we only have to take care of the patients that are in front of us today. It gets very, very, very efficient, you know, when you do that. Plus, you can hire extremely talented team members that are very good in their lane. You know, very imagine, Naren, well, you listen to phone calls.
Yes. Naren,
in Equa, you listen to your phone calls for your clients, for Equa clients.
Yes.
And you and your team provide feedback to your clients on how they're doing with calls. What if we absolutely had the A team? I'm talking about A plus on the phones. And every inbound call was no longer answered at the office. It's answered in a call center with impeccable team members. How do you think the conversion rate's going to be where we convert, you know, new callers to appointments? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be massive. I mean, like, we process 65,000 calls a month. So that's like 750,000 calls. So like, it's, let's say the conversion rate can go from 50% to even 75%. You're looking at 100,000 of new patients more, right? So yeah, it's massive. It's just tiny changes in the percentage can make a big difference.
Yeah. But I found in having done this now multiple times, I found that, you know, in a coaching capacity, I have found that once we get to four locations, we can start to think about building an admin support team that can relieve some of the burden on the individual locations and better serve the patient base by having super qualified team members. You know, imagine having an insurance coordinator that was the absolute Michael Jordan of insurance coordinators. How would that be, Naren?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, this is kind of what I did with the Equa too. Like, we have one team of writers that are 15 people and they just do writing. One team of webmasters, they just build websites. One team of designers, they just design. So when you have those specialists, they tend to get really, really, really good at it.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. You know, and you've got a NAP team, a name, address, phone. You know, they're building NAP consistency. Well, I'll stick with that Michael Jordan analogy. I use that because Naren went to school in Chicago, and he went to school in Chicago when Michael Jordan was playing. I mean, and I'll still vote for him as the all-time greatest NBA player. Yes. There's room for debate. There's room for debate in that. And
not in my mind, but anyways.
Okay, if you're a Kobe Bryant fan, send the hate mail to Naren. but I'll still give Michael Jordan that nod. But imagine that I think of your team as the NAP, you know, Michael Jordan of NAP consistency. And if you don't have that in your practice, doctors, you need to get that in your practice because it makes a massive difference in your effectiveness in digital marketing. But, you know, really that support team can get can create levels of efficiency that you simply can't do you know, in a solo location where to some degree your admin team has to be super generalist. Make sense, Naren?
Next question. Yes, absolutely, Gary. I totally understand the benefit of that. Are banks willing to finance the purchase of future practices for my DSO?
Yeah, you know, my short answer to that is it depends. It depends on you. Are you bankable? You know, what's your FICO score? Do you have a strong, you know, credit score? Do you have good history in your practice? Do you have a history with the bank? You know, there's lots of variables involved. The short answer is yes to a degree. Yes to a degree. Let me give you an example. I shared with you that I have a client that we started with two and currently have 14 practices. Their bank said to them, and this was two doctors, established strong credit profile, very responsible financially, and a good bank customer. They approached their bank and said, you know, we're going to be acquiring. We're not going to be starting practice. We're going to be acquiring them, and we're going to need a funding source. We have resources, but we're going to need to borrow some money to do this. And their banker was very honest and said, you've been a great customer of ours. We will provide you funding for the next four acquisitions. Next four. Beyond that, and we're not so sure. And their individual banker said, frankly, we don't know a lot about DSOs, and it's uncharted territory. We know a lot about lending to a dentist to buy a practice, a solo practice. We know a lot about that, but we don't know a lot about DSOs. And so they said, we will provide you, they were looking at buy-in practices around $800,000 in the purchase price. So the next four, the bank was saying, hey, we'll give you a letter of credit for about $3.2 million to buy four of those. Beyond that, and we'll take them case by case, but you may bump into a brick wall with us because the loan committee doesn't understand it. So let me tell you what they found out. They, in fact, used that bank funding to buy the next four.
Mm-hmm.
After that, they didn't need any more bank funding. They could fund future first purchases on the cash flow from the six, their two that they initially had, the four that they acquired, six. They could fund the future acquisitions off of the cash flow from those six. Does that make sense, Naren? Did I explain that in
makes
a way that makes sense?
Makes total sense, Gary. Yeah.
Yeah. And I've encountered this multiple times where sometimes you're up against an individual lending limit of a banker. In my client that has the 10, his banker says, I can approve collectively up to $4 million. And you and I have worked together. I know you, I know your credit profile. I can approve up to $4 million. Beyond that, I got to take it to committee, and then it's a different level of approval that it takes. So what I would look at this as saying, build your credit profile as strong as you can. You can certainly use bank financing for the second, third, fourth, maybe even fifth location, like I shared with you, the bank approved for. After that, you may not need it because I would like to keep your debt as under control as possible. If you could do it with cash flow, even better. And the cash flow from the enterprise might be enough to do your next acquisitions.
Right. Last question.
Pretty attractive, huh, Nick?
Yeah, absolutely.
Pretty attractive.
Absolutely. Last question. What is the biggest challenge in building a successful DSO?
Oh, I can answer that without any hesitation. Great question. It's two. It's attracting and keeping the best dentists and attracting and keeping the best team members. There's your challenge. Now, I don't want to sugarcoat the other challenges,
mm-hmm.
like marketing. But you know what, Naren? I don't look at marketing anymore as this mystery challenge. I flat out don't. I did it one time. At one time, marketing was this big mystery where we threw stuff against the wall and see what stuck. Today, it's science.
Right.
And I have your firm, Equa, to thank for that. It's consistent. We get 80 new patients a month. I know how to grow it. And it's consistent, month in, month out. So marketing is not the biggest challenge here because I can find resources to help me with that. And the best that I know of on the planet is your firm, Equa. And I'm a paying client of Equa. But the two biggest challenges are attracting and keeping. You can attract great docs, but you got to keep them. Attracting and keeping the best docs. And then secondly, attracting and keeping the best team members. Now, would you like me to share in the short time that we have left what might be the solution to solving those challenges?
Absolutely, Gary.
Now, I'm not going to get into copious detail about this because it would require two or three other episodes. And maybe we'll do those as future episodes. But what if you were able to provide some equity to your doctors and your key team members? What if you were able to do that? And I'm not talking about massive equity because you don't want to dilute that. But what if the pot was big enough to share some of that? And what if we now had truly motivated dentists and team members that would have a piece of the pie. That could be the solution to both of those. Besides creating a great environment for them to work in and all the other things that goes with it, but maybe sharing a little bit of equity, because frankly, the multiples are attractive enough to be able to do that. And again, I'll come back full circle, doctors, if this intrigues you and that you're in the ambitious group, reach out to me and schedule a coaching strategy session. I'd love to talk to you further about this. Well, as we come into the finish line today, we had five great questions from our listeners. As we come into the finish line, you know, Naren, I talked a little bit about marketing. I want to invite our listeners to reach out to you and your team. If you'd like to have what I think is the A+ marketing resource on your team, helping you build your practice, in my opinion, that's Equa. My experience, that's Equa. You can schedule a marketing strategy session with Naren's team, and they will walk through, they'll evaluate your current marketing, let you know how you're doing, give you some analytical scoring of how Google sees your practice today and what you can do to improve that. Naren, would you put that link in the show notes, the marketing strategy meeting for Equa?
Absolutely. We'll do that.
I know normally you charge for that, but in the past you've offered that as a no charge courtesy to our listeners. Would you be willing to do that again?
100%. And Laila is our director of marketing. She would spend 6 hours, you know, doing some research, and you will learn a ton from this meeting.
Laila Stone is an amazing resource. As Naren mentioned, she'll spend 6 hours of research. She'll tell you things about your practice that you don't already know, and she'll tell you things about marketing, and in particular, how your practice can be more attractive to Google, and what you can do to be more effective with your digital marketing. Again, that'll be at thrivingdentist.com/marketing. We'll put it there, or it's in the show notes. The show notes, you can find at thrivingdentist.com. If you just scroll down, you'll find it there. Hey, on that note, thank you for listening to this episode. This is kind of a fun episode that doesn't apply to everyone, but it might be especially useful to a select few. So I'm glad you tuned in. Thanks for joining us. And hey, wasn't Marcus Blatt's a clinical tip awesome? Bonding to zirconia, it's not the mystery that some of you have experienced in the past. I love the amazing clinicians that are joining us for top clinical tips. And I want to thank Marcus for that tip. Very, very useful. Also, I want to thank you. We appreciate all of our listeners at The Thriving Dentist Show. We love what we do. We couldn't do it without you. Three things you can do to support our work. Number one, you can tell a colleague, hey, maybe you have an ambitious colleague that would like to hear about this idea of building a DSO. Share this with them. Secondly, you can go to iTunes and write us a review. If you haven't done that, we'd sure appreciate that. That'll help more dentists find us. And third thing that you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. You can do that on Google Play, on iTunes, on Spotify and Apple Music, and everywhere else you listen to your podcast. Just hit subscribe. And that means every Wednesday when we upload a new episode, it'll be automatically uploaded for your listening convenience. On that note, let me thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you that we will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.